bit of a warning here. You know, if you have any kind of triggers or anything like that, this is a fairly dark song that deals with some darker issues like suicide, things like that. I just want to put that out there before you watch this, because there could be those elements that might bother certain people. So this is the first song on the Pursuit record. This is actually the song that, if I had the choice, this would have been the first single. I just like how it's kind of a compact song, the bigger chorus, little screamy part, just a quick song that I think would have been perfect for the radio, but it wasn't meant to be, so let's get into these lyrics here. Let's start it over from the beginning. Let's play for keep so I know you can never get the best of me. So at the heart of this song, this is essentially a one-sided conversation with the dark parts of someone that's slowly taking over their mind, soul, heart, etc. It's basically the voice inside that would normally be the voice of reason, but in this case, it has turned on its host, I guess, for lack of a better word, and has started to become very destructive. Sometimes you have to end the times you serve. Whoever saves you and brings you to your knees. This is talking about whoever you serve is who saves you. And that doesn't always mean that it's in a positive way. Scenario here is being saved by an idea that is hurtful. Being brought to your knees in this case is reaching that breaking point. Knowing that there's this voice that doesn't have your best intentions, but succumbing to it anyway. I have an end here with a bit of a term of endearment. It's kind of used to contrast the line before, but it's also used in a bit of a mocking way from this voice or this entity that's kind of taking control. I think everybody knows somebody who's used a term of endearment in more of a negative way to kind of bring someone down. And that's what's going on here. Like I said before, this is a darker song. So the red that's happening in the dress is actually the blood that's spilling from the situation that's going on here. The hymn in these lines is the device that she's using to end her life, whether it's a knife, a blade, etc. It's the continuing struggle that is putting this positive spin on the awfulness that's happening. It's encouraging her by saying that these are the best times. Being in this state is better than being alive. And then the lines where, "Your right to love him and close the door, chase the blood out of your veins." That's pretty straightforward. It kind of speaks for itself. The streaming down the side streets. This is basically referring to the blood that's pouring down over the skin and filling the different cracks and crevices. It's kind of personifying that process as if it has a mind of its own and it's seeking out different places it can go and fill and take over. The image of biting your lip and smiling is basically adding this element of enjoyment. It's an easy image for someone to picture, and it has obvious connotations that they can understand. She holds him in her hands, but when she lets go, she knows it's the last time that she ever will again. And you'll find that holding on to this element here, this knife or blade, etc. Maybe there's a history of doing this, but she knows that this is the last time, and when she lets go, it'll be over. So just a little bit of backstory about this part. I was listening to this song called Make Damn Sure by Taking Back Sunday. I'll play a little clip of it. I really love the way that part sounded, and in this song in particular, I wanted to work something like that into it somehow, and this was what our take was on it. This song doesn't have a big redemption arc because not everything does, unfortunately. These are the parts where she's, you know, somewhat fighting back, even though it's too late. She's basically saying, "I am not alone. My opinion matters. My feelings matter. And the voice wasn't the only thing that was right here." It's delivered with some screaming just to kind of give some emphasis on that point. You know, sometimes when you're writing a song, you want to shine light on a subject, good or bad, and then let whoever is listening to it interpret it from there. It's pretty straightforward. It's the concept of a gravestone. There's two ways I could have ended this song, and I went back and forth on both of them quite a bit. The more I get into this songwriting process, I can kind of explain how I'll spend a week debating over one or two words on how I want something to mean. And in this instance, I could have went with "so that they know I was alive" or "that they know that I'm alive." And I chose the latter because I think it's more impactful and reiterates that this person believes this was the only way, and now she is truly alive. That's, of course, a much sadder view. And I hope that if you're struggling with anything like this, you can find relief that isn't so final. It's not easy to get past these things, and there isn't one way. And sometimes just getting through a day is victory enough. So I hope that if you're struggling with this, that you can have as many victories as possible. So that was my breakdown of In a Red Dress and Alone. It actually feels quite a bit darker when I try to explain it now than how it felt when I originally wrote it. A little bit of trivia about this song. We actually wanted to have sitar throughout the verses of it. So we found somebody, got it all lined up. We sent the song over and he was going to record his parts at his studio and send them back. Shortly after he got the song, he sent us an email back saying that he found this song to be extremely offensive and he was not going to put his instrumentation on it. So it's kind of the story of how we wanted some sitar, but we never got it. But yeah, if you like this content and want to check out the next track, subscribe. Go to Facebook, I'll post there. So until next time.